Right, welcome back to Sports Outside the Box. It's episode 108, and today, NCAA last night, man. Maryland, stop following the trend of all these top 25 teams. Stop losing to these unranked squads. Also, man, Kentucky lost to the Vols. I didn't see that coming. NBA, we saw the 76ers couldn't handle the Lakers. We saw Bradley Beal, 19-game streak of 25-plus points. Also, Caris Levert, 51-point outing and beat the Boston Celtics. Last but not least, man, Tom Brady. We got to talk about Tom Brady. Because apparently his meeting with Bill Belichick did not go right. Come on in. Stick along for the ride. This is Sports Outside the Box. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to Sports Outside the Box. It's episode 108. I hope everybody's having a great Wednesday out there. Wednesday is just flying by for me. I can't believe it's 3:30 already. I don't even know where the time went. But I hope everybody's having a great Wednesday out there. I hope your boss isn't getting on your nerves too much. I've already talked to one friend today, and she was telling me how management put everybody in a group chat. And she's like, I got to block everybody in the group chat. And I'm like, goodness gracious. Management does some crazy things sometimes. I'm fully aware management does crazy things. But I hope y'all are having a good Wednesday out there. I hope your Wednesday is going a little better than her Wednesday. And you know, I'm just trying to get back in the saddle today. So for my Wednesday, my second episode back finally after my week hiatus of being on vacation, which made me feel very weird even getting back on for the first episode. I was trying to find my grounding and my footing like I'd never done this before. I hope everybody's just having a good Wednesday out there. And to start off the show, happy birthday. We're sending birthday wishes out there to everybody who's having a birthday today. So happy birthday to everybody out there. And of course, we're going to talk about some famous people that have some birthdays today. Because we're going to talk about March the 4th, what happened in history. We're going to talk about first the Heidenberg disaster in 1936. If you don't remember that, it was 1936 in New Jersey. The Heidenberg was like a Zeppelin. They called it the Zeppelin because the guy's last name who invented it, that was his last name, of course. And the guy, other guy who helped invent it was Hugo Eckner. Like I said, it was 1936. I think it was Lakehurst, New Jersey. I believe that's where it was. And it ended up just going down. It was in a Zeppelin. It's kind of like a hot air balloon. So, but the only difference is it has a steel metal frame to go around it. Just like, it looks like a hot air balloon, but a hot air balloon has, you know, air. And it's kind of like a blimp, but a blimp, again, it's just air. It ended up going down and people ended up, 36 people died. And that's kind of like, I think it's as dark we're going to get today. That's as dark we're going to get right now for us. So, but 36 people ended up dying and it was 1936 in history on today. So that's just a little history, just a little history fact. And we're going to talk about some birthdays. Draymond Green's birthday is today, March the 4th. He just signed a new deal with Converse that just came out today. So congratulations to him and a happy birthday to him, of course. And then also Landon Donovan. If you don't know who Landon Donovan is, you are not allowed to watch the Olympics no more. At least no U.S. men's soccer. You can't watch it. Landon Donovan, that man is absolutely amazing. He's done so much for U.S. men's soccer globally. Like, Landon Donovan is known everywhere if you want to talk about for U.S. men's soccer. So my goodness, happy birthday to you, Landon Donovan. When I saw it was his birthday, I was like, I gotta shout out the birthdays then if it's his birthday. And some people say I look like Draymond Green, so I gotta shout out Draymond Green as well. But happy birthday to both of them. And we're gonna get right into some things going on in the sports world today. So first off, the NFL. Oh, now we're going to the NFL. So all sporting events, because we all know about this coronavirus, it looks pretty serious. Well, not even looks pretty serious. It is clearly serious. And we see all the states that has been being affected, like California, Florida, especially Washington State. It's been absolutely insane. And if in the sporting world, we see that Chicago State, they actually have banned the last two, well, not banned, but they've suspended the last two games of the regular season that their men's and women's team will not be taking part of, because probably because they got to go to Washington, Seattle, and the people from Washington, Seattle will have to come to Chicago. So they've canceled both of their games. And I was trying to to look at the records and try to see, because of course this is a serious matter, but I was trying to look at the records and be like, oh my gosh, these two teams could be great. And they're not. I think it was the WAC conference that they're in, and the Chicago State men have won 4 games this whole season and only won one. Oh, they've, I think it's 0 games in conference. And the women, they have won 1 game in conference the whole season and 1 game the whole season period. So not too big of a deal when it comes to these two teams. And they're also questioning if they're going to be able to, if the athletic director is questioning if they're going to allow the team to even go to participate in the WAC. You know, it's about to be champ week in the NCAA for tournament. And they're trying to see if they're going to allow them to even go and play in the tournament. The tournament will be held in Las Vegas, Nevada. And we also saw something going on today that Tom Brady, his meeting with Belichick, or the phone call he had with Belichick, did not go well. And again, this is something I talked on a podcast yesterday with Sports Chat with DJ. I talked on with his podcast. We're talking about Tom Brady, talked about Phillip Rivers, Jameis Winston, where we believe they're going to go. We even talked about down to Turbo Taylor. Tom Brady, I was like, the meeting not going good with Bill Belichick. It's kind of a surprise, kind of an obvious surprise, because we've heard tensions of before with these two. So not that big of a surprise, but a surprise enough for me that's coming down to the end of his career and they probably don't want him back. So surprise enough for me. They said there's like 12 teams out there that want him, 4 teams that would sign him today, which I was like, oh my goodness, that's a lot of teams like really interested in Tom Brady. And personally, like I said on the podcast yesterday with Sports Chat with DJ, I firmly believe that whatever team Tom Brady goes to, he's going to turn that team into a playoff team day one. If he goes to the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, it's a playoff team. Goes to the Chargers, it's a playoff team. If he goes to, I don't know, not the Cincinnati Bengals, because he ain't that good. But he ain't that good. I'm trying to do another team, the Oakland Raiders. I think he might be able to take the Oakland Raiders to the playoffs. The defense has been getting where they got that boy, Max Crosby, Clint Farrell out of Clemson last year. And of course, they got some draft picks to do some things this year. But Tom Brady goes to Oakland. He might be able to take them to the playoffs. Who knows? But Tom Brady, if you look at all the weapons he's had, especially this year, he started off the year with what? N'Keal Harry goes to IR. He had Mohamed Sanu, Julian Edelman, Josh Gordon. I think they had Josh Gordon at some point this year. I think they did. AB. Josh Gordon was there this year, but hey, Josh Gordon, AB. They had a squad. They had a really nice wide receiver core, but Mohamed Sanu is getting hurt. Josh Gordon gets traded and then suspended indefinitely. Then we see Antonio Brown. My man is crazy. He's insane. You know what I'm saying? So everything was just going downhill for the Patriots in a wide receiver department. Then Rob Gronkowski retires. He didn't want to come back. And he said, all Tom's got to do is call and I'll come back. Call me. I'll be around. He wasn't around no more. He wasn't coming back. But Tom Brady, I firmly believe whatever team he decides to go to, whatever, he's going to put his mind to it. He's going to prove to the New England Patriots that, hey, I can go out here and win games too. And let's not forget that he's asking for like, what, $30 million? Between $30, $35 million? I'd be okay with that personally. Look at all the money he's made his whole career. He really ain't been making no money. He makes money off of sponsorships. He gets his money back off of sponsorships, not from the contracts that he currently gets in from the New England Patriots. And we know the New England Patriots have never been a team that really pays out to the top tier guys on the team. The top tier guys, like, remember Trey Flowers just ended up leaving. These top tier guys end up just going somewhere else. And remember Chandler Jones ended up leaving. He went to the Cardinals. It's like, that's top tier defense that they could have had. But we got to see what's going to happen with Tom Brady. And we saw that the Pats just picked up, I can't remember what brother it was. I'm trying to think of the McCourty. It was Devin or Jason McCourty. They just picked up one of their options, so they'll be playing with them this year as well. We saw A.J. Boye traded to Denver yesterday. That was kind of big news. A.J. Boye with the Jacksonville Jaguars. Remember, he used to play for the Houston Texans. The Houston Texans were they were good with him, and then A.J. Boye, A.J. Boye, Jalen Ramsey. They had Barry Church. I was like, oh, okay, they got some DBs back here. That was about to be DBU in Jacksonville with Duval, and then Jalen Ramsey ends up leaving. A.J. Boye now traded out to Denver, so that kind of means Chris Harris Jr. probably will not be back in Denver this year. Probably will be going somewhere else. And, you know, he is kind of getting up there in age a little bit. A.J. Boyle, I think he's 28 years old. So A better move for Denver, probably, I suppose. But Chris Harris Jr. brings that veteran presence. The man, he's pretty durable. So I don't know. It'll be interesting to see where Chris Harris Jr. ends up going now that the Denver Broncos have traded for A.J. Boye. Top trade candidates, that's something I saw on NFL.com. Also on ESPN, they said Derek Carr. If Derek Carr got traded, I don't know where he would go. The worst thing I saw was the Washington Redskins. Also, we know Alshon Jeffrey, Nick Foles. The Jaguars have come out and said that they wanted to trade Nick Foles, trying get away from Nick Foles. They did give him that lucrative contract. It's going to be very interesting to see if any team's going to be able to even give him, or if they're even able to trade him. And then I'm trying to think of the Jacksonville Jaguars in the market for a quarterback. And you saw how Gardner Minshew played towards the end of last year. Are they going to be are they going to try to go get a quarterback? And I think so. Gardner Minshew's not the answer. Oh, he might be the backup, or he might need to learn a few steps or get with somebody, but he's not the answer right now. Le'Veon Bell, we all know about Le'Veon Bell. They keep talking about that potentially they're going to trade him, and Adam Gase keeps saying he wants to keep him. But I personally don't like Adam Gase as a head coach. We saw how pretty much what he did with the Miami Dolphins, ended up sending Ryan Tannehill out to Tennessee. And yeah, Ryan Tannehill did phenomenal things. So I was like, it ain't Adam Gase. It wasn't Ryan Tannehill that was the problem. It was Adam Gase. And we saw Adam Gase lost to the Miami Dolphins this year. And they gave the Miami Dolphins the first one of the season. And they gave the Cincinnati Bengals the first one of the season as well. So maybe Adam Gase is the problem. Maybe he needs to get out of New York. Odell Beckham Jr., we keep hearing speculation about him. I really don't think he's going to go anywhere. Darius Slay, Hayden Hurst. Darius Slay, I think he's probably going to stay. Hayden Hurst. Hayden Hurst probably will get traded, and I like Hayden Hurst. Hayden Hurst is like the third option for the Baltimore Ravens on the tight end position, but he does get playing time. And I know they got like Nick Boyle, Hayden Hurst, and they got one Mark Andrews. I cannot forget about Mark Andrews. He's the head honcho in the tight end position for the Baltimore Ravens. So they got a three-headed monster for the tight end position. I mean, Hayden Hurst probably will make his way out somewhere else. We're going to have to see. And, of course, Quentin Dunbar, man. Best cornerback the Redskins have had in a while, especially since they acquired Josh Norman. But we also have heard they're trying to get the kid out of Carolina. I can't even think of his name right now, but the head corner out of Carolina. And I was like, I don't know. I'd be a little wary of going back to Carolina to look for, you know, a player of a high caliber. I think his name is Bradbury. Yeah, Bradbury. I'd be a little wary of doing that. So we're going to have to see. We're going to have to see what's gonna go on. But we're going to switch gears to the NBA. Last night, man, Spurs and the Hornets. Spurs get a big win, 104-103. It was definitely needed. And who was first time coaching? Timmy Duncan, Timothy D. Man, I was so excited. I saw he was coaching, but of course, I was kind of skeptical a little bit because I was like, you know, Becky Hammon, she's up for some coaching. They kept thinking she's up for some coaching jobs, and we kept hearing speculation. That was like, what, December 12th or December 10th, when they were talking about Becky Hammon potentially getting the Knicks job. And Charles Barkley was saying, hey, Becky, don't go for that Knicks job. It's terrible. And we see the whole situation going on with Spike Lee right now. And we know the whole situation that went on with Charles Oakley. So I don't know, but I was kind of confused because Tim Duncan, I know he's been with our Spurs, what, since 98, 97? Like, pretty much, he's been there for a hot minute playing for the organization, around the organization. He's been there the whole time. So over 20 years around the organization. So I kind of got why, you know, Pop gave him the head, gave him the start yesterday when Pop had personal issues or personal reasons why he could not coach yesterday. So he gave Tim Duncan the nod to be the head coach. But Becky Hammon, I was like, okay, but she's been coaching for the Spurs since 2014. I would assume that, you know, she would have been the first woman ever yesterday to be ever coach an NBA game. And the Spurs ended up winning the game 104-103. So it could have potentially been, like a woman's first time coaching and she gets the win. I wish that would have happened. That would have been super exciting to see. But the Spurs, remember the Spurs, we played the Indiana Pacers. We started the game off 10-0. Ended up losing that game. This game, the Hornets start the game off 7-0. The Hornets ended up losing this game. DeMar DeRozan, he had 12 points, but he made up for it with 10 assists. This is fourth double-double on the season. When DeMar DeRozan has had a double-double this season, with his fourth now, we are 4-0. And I even tweeted at him today. I said, DeMar DeRozan, I'm going to need you to keep getting double-doubles, man, because we're 4-0 when you got a double-double. I'm going to need you to keep getting them. Deontay Murray, when he's over 20 points this season, we are 3-0. So I'm going to need these two guys to actually get their deal together and just keep doing what they need to do. The Spurs were down by 9 points in the third quarter. Going into the third quarter, we really revved it up, picked it up. The offense was scoring. Deontay Murray was scoring. Derek White put in some big buckets, and especially when down the stretch, I think it was Derek White who shot a three. Was that Derek White? I think, or it was Brian Forbes shot a big three. Ended up going rim out. He goes to the free throw line, knocked down all three free throws. That helped last night as well. But the big thing was Terry Rozier, the highest paid. Well, I'm not sure if he's the highest paid person on the Hornets, but the guy that the Hornets gave all that money to, and I know he's in the top 20 for guards or for point guards that are being paid this season. He actually turned the ball over, and for some reason, the score was 104-103. Turned the ball over, it was probably like 6 seconds left. The Charlotte Hornets just ended up not fouling. It was kind of weird, and DeMar DeRozan just standing there with the ball, then just chucked the ball in the air, and I was like, okay, you could have legitimately had a shot to come down the floor and actually shoot the three ball and try to tie the game. I don't know. It's kind of weird to see how that ended. But Tim Duncan gets his first win. I'm happy for Tim. I know all Spurs Nation, I know we're all happy for Tim. So go Spurs, go. That's all I got to say with that. So hopefully we can see Becky Hammon the next time. If anything happens to Pop and he needs to sit out for a couple games, we can see Becky Hammon get a chance to come in and coach. That'd be nice. Next game, Nets at the Celtics. I couldn't believe this because I legitimately turned this game off to watch my Spurs play. And the Nets, somehow, some way come back in this game and win 129-120. And I was just confused at how it even happened. So I had legitimately go back and watch the whole game. The third quarter and the third and fourth quarter. I had to go back and rewatch it because I was sitting there like, okay, well, what's happening? And this guy, Chris Chioza, I like what I saw from him. Only 20 minutes yesterday, 8 points, four assists, three rebounds. But when he was in the game, he was super effective. Caris Levert, career high, 51 points, 65.4 shooting last night. So like I said, new career highs. Previous career high came February 8th of this year against the Toronto Raptors when he had 37 points of 66.7% shooting. And Caris LeVert, I'm telling you, in the last 5 minutes, this man wasn't missing a shot. And over time, he became a grown man, not just a regular grown man. Remember, we usually hear, oh, this man, he was a grown man out there. He was a grown man. He was an adult. That's exactly what he was playing last night in overtime. I was like, Caris LeVert is having all the points. He is putting the Celtics away by himself. And of course, you got to look at Boston. And Boston, Jason Tatum, man, incredible February, 30.7 points. And he was a player of the month with LeBron James. LeBron was the player of the month in the Western Conference and Jason Tatum in the Eastern Conference. But Jason Tatum, 30.7 points, 7.9 rebounds, 3.2 assists in 12 games in February. So you're missing a 30-point score. I know Marcus Smart gets put into the rotation for the starting lineup, but Marcus Smart played great yesterday. But it makes a huge difference when you don't have Jason Tatum on the floor, and I really thought that was probably the reason why they lost the game. Even though they have a lot of talent, they have there's no excuse why they lost this game, because they shouldn't have lost this game. I'm like, you have Kemba Walker, Marcus Smart, Jaylen Brown. I think Jaylen Brown had 22 points. He was the point go-getter for the Celtics last night with the team high. And they have, of course, Rami Langford. They got Grant Williams, the young guys. And I was like, there's really no excuse as to why they lost this game. Caris LeVert just ended up snapping. He had him going off 51 points. They couldn't stop him. So that's pretty much when it went on yesterday. Big win for the Nets, of course, because the Nets were on a four-game losing streak. So big win for the Nets. They definitely needed that win. Timberwolves at the Pelicans. I couldn't believe this one either. Timberwolves get the win 139-134. And you would think that the way the Pels have been rolling as of late, you would think that they would have grabbed this win. But Zion Williamson, another great game. Brandon Ingram, a great game. Lonzo Ball, a great game. Josh Hart, I think he poured in 11 points off the bench as well. In the fourth quarter, it was tied 122-122. Then all of a sudden, it was D-Lo time. D-Lo comes down, knocks down a three-pointer. All of a sudden, he makes an assist, the guy in the corner for a nice shot. Then all of a sudden, another guy came down, made a three. And then you see D'Angelo Russell. He's like, hold up, let me show you a little step-back game I got for mid-range. He pretty much was putting that game away, and it was why. And if you look at the Minnesota Timberwolves roster, only two people like this season coming into this season were on this roster last year. They completely overhauled this. This roster, and I'm just like impressed because of course they went out and got Malik Beasley, 28 points last night. He came from the Denver Nuggets this season in a trade. D'Angelo Russell, 23 points, 8 assists. He came from the Warriors. James Johnson, 19 points, 6 rebounds, 5 assists. He came from the Miami Heat. And then of course, Juancho, Juanacho, I know I'm saying his name wrong. Juancho Hernan Gomez. I always want to say his first name, but I can never get it right. 16 points, 8 rebounds, and he came from the Nuggets as well as Malik Beasley. And that's another reason why I was mad the Wizards could be gave up Jordan McRae. And I was like, why didn't we get Malik Beasley? We got Malik Beasley here. But if you want to look at the rookie class that came in this season that was not here last season, Jared Culliver averaging 9.1 points per game. He had 11 points last night. Naz Reid and Jordan McLaughlin both had 13 points last night. Both rookies. And like the only two people that come into this year on this roster, Karl-Anthony Towns and Josh Okogie. And Josh Okogie, he's been playing absolutely phenomenal. Karl-Anthony Towns, when he's playing, absolutely phenomenal. This team just needs a little minute to gel. So of course next season we'll see how well they're going to be playing together, but they just need a little time to gel. And I really think this team will be a good team, and especially we're coming up to the NBA draft. The NBA draft is like July, August, but we're coming up to the NBA draft. It's going to be here as soon as you know it. And I'm just excited to see what's going to happen, because I know the Minnesota Timberwolves are going to have like a top 10. They're going to be in the lottery. And just to add to the talent they already have, and they have really young talent. And like I said, like you already named, and I didn't even put everybody on the team on this list, but they have really young talent on this team. Like D'Angelo Russell's young, Malik Beasley's young, James Johnson ain't young. He ain't young. He's been in the league since like 2008, 2009. He ain't young. But they got a lot of young talent. Cat's young. I can't wait to see what's going to happen with this team. Jrue Holiday last night, 27 points, 10 rebounds, 12 assists, triple-double, and getting a loss. I'd be so upset. Lonzo Ball, 26 points, 8 assists. He was balling last night from three. I think he had between 5 and 7 three-pointers. Zion Williamson, no surprise, 25 points, 8 rebounds. Brandon Ingram, 24 points, no surprise. Derek Favors, he put in 10 points and 6 rebounds. And the big problem that happened was the comparison off the bench. Pelicans had 22 points off the bench. You look at the Timberwolves, 48 points off the bench. That was the big problem last night for the Pelicans. The starters pretty much had to stay in. The starters had to try to do everything to get the win. And that's where the problem lied at. Also, going at the free throw line, it really didn't help the Pelicans, going 16 of 27, 59.3% from the free throw line. That surely did not help them. Timberwolves, 17 of 20. So I'm like, you missed 11 free throws last night, and then you lose the game by 5 points. So it's kind of your fault why you lost the game. They gotta do a lot better. So they play the Mavericks. The Pelicans actually play the Mavericks tonight. So hopefully they keep that in mind, that they can actually, you know, we actually gotta make our free throws. We can't be BSing around. We gotta actually go out here and make our free throws. Also last night, we got the Clippers playing the Thunder. Clippers win the game 109-104. Kawhi Leonard, 25 points and 8 rebounds. Paul George, 16 points. The Big Four showed up for OKC, but they just couldn't get the win. SGA, CP3, Dennis Schroeder, Danilo Gallinari, they all showed up last night, but they just couldn't get the win. And of course, when you combine everybody else's stats, when you take out the Big Four for OKC, everybody else's stats combined to 9 of 26 shooting, 34.6%. The biggest difference in this game, yet again, free throws. OKC shot 65.4% from the free throw line, missing a total of 9 free throws. And you put the 9 in there, it's 109-103. So they still don't get the win, but they put themselves in a better position to try to knock down some three-point shots, or, you know, you put more pressure on people, and maybe that added pressure makes people miss shots. Not Kawhi Leonard, but, you know, anybody but Kawhi Leonard. He likes to end people on game sevens. So not Kawhi Leonard. Warriors surprisingly get a big win last night against the Nuggets, 116-110. I was very shocked about that. And I wish I would have looked up the stats for the Nuggets, because I really want to see what Gary Harris did. I'm always so enthused, and I know you guys always hear me. I'm so enthused about what Gary Harris is doing and how well he's playing. But Andrew Wiggins and Eric Pascal, they both go over 22 points last night. The most shocking thing was the fact that since they were up by 15 at one point in the game, the Nuggets ended up just losing. The Warriors out-rebounded them 53-35, and they had a total of 19 offensive rebounds. I'm just like, okay, well, what lost in the game? It was like pretty much the 3-point shots, because the Nuggets were up by 15. I'm like, you out-rebounded them by 18, and you had 19 offensive rebounds. So I'm like, what lost you the game? It was the 3-pointers. That's exactly. They only made 3 of them. The Warriors made 18. So it was like, you know, yeah, I can't win in the NBA. somebody's making 18 3-pointers. That's ridiculous. So 3 to Curry to 18, and then you do the math. That's an extra 45 points from 3-point land that they got over the Nuggets. So that's pretty much what did it for them. Raptors and Suns. Raptors went 123-114. No surprise there. Kyle Lowry, Norman Powell, Pascal Siakam. We're not playing around. Siakam, 33 points and 7 boards. And we got Kyle Lowry, 28.6 assists. Norman Powell, he goes 26 points. But the big surprise to me is the fact that this guy, Christian Boucher, 19 points and 15 boards. And this guy, this is the same guy that I was sitting there talking about maybe 3 weeks ago, maybe 2.5 to 3 weeks ago. This guy like randomly just put in 25 points, I believe. And I was like, okay, well, who's Christian Boucher? And then to see him go for 19 points and 15 boards, I say, okay, well, who is this? And of course, last night the Suns were missing Kelly Oubre, so we can't be mad at the Suns too much. But definitely missing Kelly Oubre. I was hoping DeAndre Ayton played a little better than what he did. He did get a double-double, though. Wizards and the Kings last night, 133-126. The Kings won the game. Unfortunately, Bradley Beal, another 35-point performance and a 19-game streak of now 25 points plus. De'Aaron Fox put in 31 points last night for the Kings, keeping it rolling for the Kings right now. The Kings are now only they're on a 3-game winning streak, and they're 3 games outside of the Grizzlies for that 8th seed in the Western Conference. So it's going to be very interesting to see what's going to happen there. And lucky for them, the Pelicans got a loss last night. The Suns lost last night. And the Blazers haven't been too hot lately without Damian Lillard, but he's supposed to be back tomorrow, I believe. So we're going to have to see what's going to happen there. But the Kings are starting to roll a little bit, 3 games behind them. 3 games behind. I just said the team's name, too. 3 games behind. Screw it, I forgot. I forgot that quickly. 3 games behind the 8th seed. Let's put it that way. 3 games behind the 8th seed. The 76ers and the Lakers. Lakers 120-107. This game was a little surprising because the 76ers were playing so well in the first half. They were playing so well, like, without, like, between, it was like maybe 7 minutes or 8 minutes left in the second quarter. And all of a sudden the Lakers were like, I don't know what Frank Vogel said to them in that timeout, but all of a sudden I saw Rondo hit a step back three. And I said, I am not watching the same game in the same universe anymore. I'm in a different space and time because Rondo just did the James Harden step back three and knocked it down. I couldn't believe it. I said, this is blasphemous. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. I think he only had like 9 points last night or 11 points, but he knocked down 2 big threes, and the Lakers won the game 120-107. Braun had 22 points and 14 assists. And then, of course, AD, 37 points, 13 rebounds, 4-for-5 from the three-point land. And I'm telling you, LeBron James, he needs to cut it out. I don't know if he's like feeling himself or Damian Lillard and Steph Curry gave him some power because they're both not playing right now. But back-to-back games, we've seen LeBron James, like, he's just walking up, and then all of a sudden he's like, oh, hold on, let me hit this shot for you real quick from the logo. And I was like, okay, if I start calling him Logo Braun out here. And I hashtagged that last night on Instagram, Logo Braun. I just couldn't believe what he was doing. Some games going on tonight. The Celtics playing the Cavs. OKC's playing the Pistons. And that game's kind of big because OKC needs to make up for that loss they had last night. Pacers are playing the Bucks at 7 o'clock on ESPN. Magic going against the Miami Heat. That's going to be a big game because the Magic need to keep pace. The Magic are the 8th seed. Oh, the 7th seed right now. So the fact that the Nets won last night was kind of big, and the Magic need to keep going up. They need to keep trending upwards. And the team, I forgot their name, who I was thinking about, the 8th seed in the Western Conference, the Grizzlies, they're playing the Nets tonight, and that's kind of big because they're both in the 8th seeds in the both respective conferences. The Jazz are playing the Knicks. We saw what the Knicks did the last game. Surprisingly enough, got a win over the Houston Rockets. Or can they get a win over the Utah Jazz? The Bulls going against the T-Wolves. Can't wait to see what the Bulls do tonight. The T-Wolves played a great game last night. Bulls, we saw what Otto Porter did the other night in 17 minutes, 18 points. Can he do it again tonight? And I wonder if Zach LaVine's going to play. If Zach LaVine's going to play, I can't wait to see the trio of Kobe White, Zach LaVine, and Otto Porter. Absolutely phenomenal trio, I believe. Pelicans playing the Mavericks tonight. Pelicans lost last night. Should have beat the T-Wolves, but can they beat the Mavericks tonight? Mavericks, remember, they just lost a bad loss to the Bulls. That's the team that the Bulls beat without Zach LaVine. Otto Porter came back. So both teams coming off a loss, they need a win. That game's at 9:30 on ESPN. Wizards are playing the Blazers. Hopefully, you know, there's no Dame tonight. So hopefully, you know, the Wizards can do a little something. Hopefully we can see Bradley Beal is going to go for another 30 or over 25 points again. It's going to be a 20 game streak for him. So I can't wait to see what's going to happen. The Wizards are always in a close game. We can never just finish it off. And don't forget, big game on Thursday. Clippers are playing the Rockets at 8 o'clock. I can't wait for that game as well. NCAA basketball news. I think I already told you about the news, the coronavirus, about the, you know, the team in Chicago State, and Elliot Charles, the director, said, they're not going to be playing no games against Washington State, no games against against Utah and Seattle. So, and like I said, here are the stats. So Chicago, Chicago men are 0-14 in the WAC, the WAC conference, and they're 4-25 overall. The Chicago State women are 1-13 in the WAC, and they're 1-26 overall. So not too good, not too good at all. So let's just go to NCAA basketball from last night. Number 9 Maryland. We might as well just get it out the way now, because I didn't even want to talk about it. But number 9 Maryland. Come on, man. Losing to Rutgers 78-67. And we know Rutgers is one of the top defensive teams in the country, as well as Maryland. But Maryland allows 78 points, and we typically don't allow teams to go that high on us. One point in the game, Maryland was down 21 points, and that kind of was hurting my soul. I was actually on the phone doing the podcast with the dude Sports Chat with DJ, and I was doing the podcast sitting there looking at the Maryland game, and I was like, what are you guys doing? Y'all are killing me. And it was just a post that I had just put up on Sports Outside the Box on Instagram talking about would Maryland lose, and whoever made the post said, yes, Maryland will lose to Rutgers, and whoever made it was right, because Rutgers' defense was shutting us down. One point in the game, down by 21 points. It was absolutely heart-wrenching. Montez Mathis last night, 15 points for the Scarlet Knights. And then we also saw Jacob Young. He had 17 points. He had some pristine shooting going on, 3-for-3 from the three-point line. So that was definitely not good to see. But of course, you know, when you're Rutgers, that was good for him and the Scarlet Knights to have. Also, we saw in the second half of this game that Maryland just completely got outdone. Rutgers wasn't playing around. Rutgers was actually just pounding it away. And then you're sitting there like, oh, they're up by 21. Then all of a sudden we bring it back down to 11. We end up losing the game 78-67. It was kind of a big loss because Michigan State also played last night. Let's just flip over to Michigan State real quick, then we'll talk about why it was such a big game. Number 16, Michigan State playing. Number 20, Penn State. Michigan State wins the game 79-71. Huge win for Michigan. And I'm going to talk to you why it was so huge in just a minute. But players of the game, Cassius Winston and Xavier Tillman, at one point in this game, they're on a 24-3 run, and Cassius Winston and Coach Izzo were arguing, and I was like, I have never in all of my days, never in all of my being, seen any team being up 24-3 on a 20, no, sorry, not up 24-3, but you're on a 24-3 run. A 24-3 run, and somehow, some way, you and your coach are arguing on the sideline. And I was like, "What is going on here?" So that was probably like the craziest part of the game. I'm telling you, I've never seen that. And like, you know how like big of an accomplishment that is. You're going against a ranked team, the 20th best team in the country, and you're on a 24-3 run. So I was like, "Okay, I don't know what's going on." But Coach Izzo said after the game that everything was cool between the two. He's like, "Maybe I should walk up to him and give him a hug and a kiss. And see what you guys say after that." And I was like, don't do all that. But I understood what he was saying. He said he loves the fact that Cassius Winston's not afraid to show his true colors out on the floor. So, you know, you got to love that as a coach. Your players aren't going to hold back, and they're not going to sit there and talk behind your back. They're going to talk to you to your face and tell you exactly what they think. But, you know, you ain't supposed to do it all the time. But, you know, sometimes it ain't too bad to do. But why this game was so big for Michigan State. So Michigan State winning this game and Maryland losing to Rutgers. Now they are both tied on top of the Big Ten. But the Maryland has the better overall record. But the big thing that could happen now is Michigan, Maryland plays number 25 Michigan Sunday at 12 o'clock, and then I believe Michigan State plays Ohio State, I want to say. Yeah, Michigan plays number 19 Ohio State Sunday at 4:30. So if Maryland wins, Maryland's the number one seed going into the Big Ten tournament. If Maryland loses, Michigan State wins, then we'll be the number two team, because then Michigan State will have the better conference record than Maryland would have. So it's like everything's just been falling apart for Maryland. I don't know what's going on with it. It's been like completely upsetting. It's like we lost the last three of four. I'm trying to say that we lost the last three of four games. So I'm not too excited to see what's been going on as of late. It's kind of like what happened to Duke, kind of almost what happened to Kentucky last night. Like, you're not trying to see your team take these big losses walking into, you know, March Madness or even Champ Week. So it's definitely something we're going to have to keep an eye on. And I know from a Maryland standpoint, if Maryland loses to Michigan and, you know, they just got Livers back, that's going to be absolutely a huge game. And I know Michigan State's looking to win that game. And I want to say that game is in Michigan. I hope it's not in Michigan, but I want to say it is in Michigan. OSU will actually be playing in Michigan State. So lucky for Michigan State. Next game, Tennessee playing Kentucky, and Tennessee playing number six Kentucky. Tennessee comes back and they win a game 81-73. Utterly shocking, because I'm sitting there like, okay, so Maryland's been losing games. Duke's been losing games. Baylor's been losing games. We saw San Diego State's been losing games. And now Kentucky falls to the Vols 81-73. John Fulkerson, had to make sure I said that name right, 27 points last night, and Yves Pond hit big threes down the stretch. I think he had 15 points, 5 rebounds, but big shots down the stretch for Yves Pond last night. Nick Richardson is now on a 9-game streak of not having a double-double. Emmanuel Quickie had his lowest point total, 15 last night, since January. He had 17 or more points for the whole month of February, walking right into March, and he had a 15-point game. They definitely needed a lot more out of him. And remember, like 2-3 games ago, he just put up a 31-point game, and then after that was like 23 points. So they definitely needed some more production out of him last night. And we know Kentucky's one of the better defensive teams in the country as well, especially for scoring. They are one of the top scoring teams in the country. So kind of strange to see how they fell last night. Now, with a huge win for Tennessee, they're going to try to claw their way back into the big dance. They're only one win behind Florida, South Carolina, and Mississippi State. The last game of the season for number 17, Auburn, will be Saturday at 12 p.m. And then the last game we got is Purdue versus number 18 Iowa, and Purdue upsets Iowa 77-68. And remember, the first time these two teams played during the year, Purdue actually scored what, 19 3-pointers? They were 19 of 34 from the 3-point line the first time these two teams met. I think it was one of the worst losses Iowa's had, and Purdue ends up doing it again. But 77-68, they only made 8 3-pointers. Purdue made 8 threes. Iowa made 8 threes as well. But they got the thing that helped them. They got inside and they got offensive rebounds. How many offensive rebounds do you think they had? 21. Yeah, they had 21 offensive rebounds. And I'm not talking about the whole game. I mean offensive rebounds solely. So I was completely impressed. But when I heard that, I was like, wow, 21 offensive rebounds. That's a lot of rebounds on the offensive end, especially if we don't talk about second chance points. Eric Hunter, 19 points. Evan Bordreau, he had 14 points, 14 rebounds for the Boilermakers. Iowa, Luca Garza, 26 points, 12 rebounds, 4 steals, 4 blocks. I can't wait to see what he's going to do in the NBA. Iowa's so shifty with him, but I can't wait to see what he does in the NBA. He's averaging 23.7 points this year, 9.9 rebounds, field goal percentage 54%. I'm going to be so excited. Like him, Obi Toppin, Jalen Smith, like the big guys. I can't wait to see what these guys do. Also, what's the guy? Childs, well, with BYU. I can't wait to see what these guys doing the NBA. I'm so excited to see. Yeah, Yoli Childs for BYU. Can't wait to see what they're going to do. But last but not least, I'm going to talk about go over some big games going on today. So we got Texas A&M playing number 17 Auburn. We also have TCU. They definitely need a win. I don't know if they can make the NCAA tournament. They're 16-13, but 7-9 in the Big 12. They're going against number 1 Kansas. Georgetown, I highly doubt they make the tournament at this point. They're going against number 11, Creighton. Number 14, Villanova's playing number 8, Seton Hall. We know Seton Hall's already beaten Villanova this year, so that's a good game. Number 3, Dayton's playing Rhode Island. Rhode Island has a chance. Rhode Island's been making the tournament as of late. I think the past 3 years they made the tournament, so I think Rhode Island probably should make it, especially with their record right now, 20-8, but they're 12-4 in the A-10. Also, we have Florida State playing Notre Dame. Virginia's playing number 22 Virginia going to Miami. We have Northwestern going against number 24 Wisconsin. That's probably the worst game on Northwestern going against number 24 Wisconsin. That's probably the worst game. That's a Big Ten game. And the Northwestern women, my goodness, they are phenomenal. I think they're only ranked like 13, but they won the Big Ten for the women. But and Maryland came second. But the men don't have the same luck. The men don't have the same apparently ability as the women. women do down there. So that's all I got for you today, man. Everybody, thank you for joining me on another episode of Sports Outside the Box. And remember, I did that podcast with a guy, Sports Chat with DJ. His name is spelled D-E-E-J-A-Y. Go listen to that last podcast. Absolutely phenomenal. I had a great time doing it. So everybody, thank you for joining me on another episode of Sports Outside the Box. I will see you tomorrow. Have a good night, everybody. And just remember to always keep that Mamba mentality.